day of the funeral. It was snowing so bad. Big, big wet snowflakes. And then when I got there, there were thousands of people in just black and with umbrellas everywhere. And there were two churches, one for like the immediate family and then invited guests and things of that nature, and then a whole another church for just everyone else who just wanted to be there. And then still, hundreds of people around everywhere who just couldn't fit in either of the churches. And there was a park by the church, and that's where these people were. And the park was full.
The liturgy today is an Easter liturgy. It finds its meaning in the resurrection. The service invites your full participation. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
And I guess it was like the worst storm that they've ever had.
Tiffany Edwards.
Like that anybody could ever tell. Like trees fell down and the power was out for a couple days because of it. And you know, I just thought, it's like the forces of nature at work, you know? Like, whatever higher power is out there that blows storms was blowing this storm.
For our brother Matthew, let us pray to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. We pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
Lord, you who consoled Martha and Mary in their distress, draw near to us who mourn for Matthew, and dry the tears of those who weep. We pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. We pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Give to our brother eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our brother the joys of heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
He was nourished with your body and blood. Grant him a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. We pray to the Lord.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our brother. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. We pray to the Lord.
My most striking memory from the funeral?
Carrie Drake, Casper Star Tribune.
Is seeing the Reverend Fred Phelps from Kansas, the scene go up in the park?
Do you believe the Bible? Do you believe you're supposed to separate the precious from the vile? You don't believe that part of the Bible? You stand over there ignorant of the fact that the Bible, two times to every verse, it talks about God's love, it talks about God's hate.
A bunch of high school kids who got out early came over and started yelling at some of these people in the protest, the Fred Phelps people. And across the street, you had people lining up for the funeral. Well, I remember a guy. I remember this skinhead coming over, and he was dressed in leather and spikes everywhere. He came over from across the street where the protest was, and he came into the crowd. And I just thought, oh, this is going to be a really ugly confrontation. But instead, he came over and he started leading them in Amazing Grace.
We wouldn't be here if this was just another murder the state was going to deal with. State deals with hundreds of murders every single day. But this murder is different because the feds are bringing us out here trying to make Matthew Shepard into a poster boy for the gay lifestyle. And we're going to answer it. It's just that simple.
6 months later, the company returned to Laramie for the trial of Russell Henderson, the first of the two perpetrators. It was to be a capital murder trial. And when we got to the Albany County Courthouse, Fred Phelps was already there.
You don't like that attribute of God.
But so was Romaine Patterson.
That perfect attribute of God. Well, we love that attribute of God, and we're going to preach it. Because God's hatred is pure. It's a determination. It's a determination that he's going to send some people to hell. That's God's hatred.
After seeing Fred Phelps protesting at Matthew's funeral, and finding out he was coming back to Laramie to protest the trial of Russell Henderson, I decided that somebody needs to go toe-to-toe with this guy and show the difference. And I think that what we're talking about, hatred as much as the nation is right now, that there needs to be somebody to show there's a better way of dealing with that kind of hatred. So, our idea is to dress up like angels. And so, we designed this angel costume of these wings, these big-ass wings. And what we're going to do is there's going to be 10 to 20 of us dressed up as angels. And
and we're gonna encircle Phelps, and because of our big wings, we're gonna completely block him. So this big ass band of angels comes in. We don't say a fucking word. We just turn our backs to him and we stand him. And we're a group of people bringing forth a message of peace and love and compassion. And we're calling it angel action. Yeah, this 21-year-old little lesbian's ready to walk the line with him.
When those old preachers laid their hands on me, it was called an ordination. Then they deliver charge. Mine was from Isaiah 58:1. Cry out, spare not! Lift up thy voice like a trumpet and show my people their transgression.
And I knew my angels were going to be taking the brunt of everything he had to yell and say. I mean, we were going to be blocking his view and he was going to be pissed off to all hell. So I went out and bought all my angels earplugs.
Romaine Patterson's sister, Trish Steger.
As soon as they started the jury selection, you know, everybody was coming into my shop with, oh, I don't want to be on this trial, I hope they don't call me, or, oh my God, I've been called, what do? How do I get off? You know, just wanting to get as far away from this jury as possible. And then I heard that Pat Henderson had to sit in the courtroom while they questioned the prospective jurors. One of the questions they asked was, would you be willing to put this person to death? I understand a lot of the comments were, yes, I would.
Yes, I would, Your Honor.
Yes, sir?
Absolutely.
Yes, sir.
No problem. Yep.
Can you imagine hearing that? You know, juror after juror after juror?
You entered a not guilty plea earlier, Mr. Henderson. But I understand you wish to change your plea today, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
You understand, Mr. Henderson, that the recommended sentence here is two life sentences?
Yes, sir.
You do understand that they may run concurrently or they may run consecutively?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Henderson, I will now ask you how you wish to plead, guilty or not guilty?
Guilty.
Before the court decides whether sentences will be concurrent or consecutive, I understand that there are statements to be made by at least one individual.
This is an excerpt from a statement made to the court by Lucy Thompson.
As the grandmother and the person who raised Russell, along with my family, we have written the following statement. Our hearts ache for the pain and suffering that the shepherds have went through. We have prayed for your family since the very beginning. Many times throughout the day, I have thought of Matthew, and you will continue to be in our thoughts and prayers, as we know that your pain will never go away. You have shown such mercy in allowing us to have this plea, and we are so grateful that you are giving us the opportunity to live. Your Honor, we as a family hope that as you sentence Russell, that you will do it concurrently to life terms. For the Russell we know and love, we humbly plead, Your Honor, to not take Russell completely out of our lives forever.
Thank you, Ms. Thompson. Mr. Henderson, you have a constitutional right to make a statement if you would like to do so. Do you have anything you would like to say?
Yes, I would, Your Honor. Mr. and Mrs. Shepherd, there is not a moment that goes by that I don't see what happened that night. I know what I did was very wrong, and I regret greatly what I did. You have my deepest sympathies for what happened. I hope that one day you will be able to find it in your hearts to forgive me. Your Honor, I know what I did was wrong. I'm very sorry for what I did, and I'm ready to pay my debt for what I did.
Mr. Henderson, you drove the vehicle that took Matthew Shepard to his death. You bound him to that fence in order that he might more savagely be beaten, and in order that he might not escape to tell his tale.
You left him out there for 18 hours, knowing full well that he was there. Perhaps having an opportunity to save his life, you did nothing. Mr. Henderson, this court does not believe that you really feel any true remorse for this, your part in this matter. And I wonder whether you fully realize the gravity of what you've done. The court finds it appropriate, therefore, that sentence be ordered as follows. As to count three, that being felony murder with robbery, you are to serve a period of imprisonment for the term of your natural life. On count one, kidnapping, that you serve a period of imprisonment for the term of your natural life. Sentencing for count one, to run consecutive to sentencing for count three.
After the hearing, we spoke with Russell Henderson's Mormon homeschool teacher.
I've known Russell's family for 38 years. Russell's only 21, so I've known him his entire life. I ordained Russell a priest of the Mormon Church, so when this happened, you can imagine disbelief. After the sentencing, the church held a disciplinary council, and the result of that meeting was to excommunicate Russell from the church. And what that means is that your name is taken off the church records so that you just disappear. Russell's reaction to this was not positive. It hurt him. And it hurt him too to realize at that point how serious a transgression he had committed. But I will not desert Russell. That is a matter of my religion and of my friendship with the family.
Before we left Laramie, we met again with Rebecca Hilliker at the theater department. She is producing Angels in America this year at the university.
And that's the focus the university has taken, that we have a lot of work to do. We have an obligation to find ways to reach our students, and, well, the question is, how do we move? I mean, how do we teach a whole state where there is some really deeply seated hostility towards gays? How do you reach them? This is the beginning. And guess who's auditioning for the lead?
My parents.
Jedediah Schultz.
So my parents ask me, what plays are you doing at school this year? And I tell them, Angels in America, and I list all the other plays. Then my mom's like, hold up, Angels in America? Isn't that that play you did in high school? That scene that you did in high school? And I'm like, yeah. And she's like, well, are you gonna audition for it? And I said, yeah. And we got into this whole big fight and everything. And the best thing I can come up with was, well, I was just in a production of Macbeth, and I played a guy who killed these two guys, Lady Macduff and a little kid. And she goes, well, you know, homosexuality is a sin. And I go, Mom, I just played a murderer tonight, and you didn't seem to have any problem with that. Man, I tell you, I've never auditioned for something so hard in my life. Never, ever. Not even close.
Not having to deal that much with the gay society here at Laramie.
Detective Sergeant Rob DeBray.
Well, once we started working the case and actually speaking with the people that were gay and finding out what their underlying fears were, well, it sort of hit home. This is America. You don't have a right to feel that kind of fear. And we're still going to have people who hold with the old ideals, and I was probably one of them 14 months ago. I'm not going to put up with it, and I'm not going to listen to it. And if they don't like my views on it, then fine. The door goes both ways, and I already lost a couple of buddies. I don't care. I feel more comfortable, and I can sleep at night.
Well, you're tested every 3 months.
Reggie Flutie.
And I was able to have the DNA test done, and they got me to Fort Collins. They drew the blood there and flew it to Michigan. We did all the DNA work there, which was a week later. I knew I was negative for good.
I tell you, we were all on our knees saying Hail Marys.
Oh, you feel just so elated, you think, thank God.
So what's the first thing she does?
I stuck my tongue in my husband's mouth. you're just so happy, you think, yeah, I did my service well, you know. I hope I did it with some kind of integrity, so... You're just really, really happy. And my daughters, well, they just bawled.
Oh, they were so happy.
And the force.
Oh, boy.
Oh, we went out and we got shit-faced.
Shit-faced.
They all bought me drinks, too. It was great. And everybody hugged and cried. And I kissed everybody who walked through that door.
Oh, Reggie, now they don't need to know that.
Didn't care if they were male or female. They each got a kiss on the lips.
Now, what part of what I just said didn't you understand?
Oh, get over it, Ma.
Almost a year is the day that Matthew Shepard died. The trial for Aaron James McKinney was set to begin. Probably the question that most of you have in your mind is, how the McKinney case will proceed?
Cal Verrucha, prosecuting attorney.
And it's the decision of the county's attorney office that will definitely be a death penalty case.
Well, part of me wants McKinney to get it. I'm not very proud of that. I was on and off and on. I can't say what I would do. I'm too personally involved.
Well, I believe in the death penalty 100%. You know, this is one instance where I want to see that guy's ass dies. I believe firmly with all my heart, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth.
I don't know about the death penalty, but I don't ever want to see them walk out of Rowland's Pound of Penitentiary. I'll pay my nickel or whatever my percentage of tax. Nickel a day to make sure that his ass stays in there and never sees society again. And never comes into my bar again.
I don't believe in the death penalty. It's too much for me. I don't believe that one person should be killed as redemption for killing another. Two wrongs don't make a right.
How can I protest if the Shepherds want McKinney dead? But I just can't interfere with that. But on a personal note, I knew Aaron in grade school. We never called him Aaron. He was called AJ. How can we put A.J. McKinney to death?
I think right now our most important teachers must be Russell Henderson and Aaron McKinney. They have to be our teachers. How did they learn? What did we as a society do to teach them that? See, I don't know if many people will let them be their teacher. I think it would be wonderful if the judge said, in addition to your sentence, you must tell your story. You must tell your story.
All rise. State of Wyoming v. Aaron James McKinney, docket 6381. The Honorable Martin R. Watt presiding. The court is in session.
During the trial of Aaron McKinney, the prosecution played a tape recording of his confession.
My name is Rob Debris, sergeant for the sheriff's office. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and may be used against you in a court of law.
The following is an excerpt of that confession.
Okay. So you guys, you and Russ, go to the fireside. So you're at the fireside by yourselves, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Where do you go after you leave the fireside?
Some kid wanted a ride home.
What did he look like?
Like a queer? Such a queer dude.
He looks like a queer?
Yeah, like a fag, you know?
Okay. How did you meet him?
He wanted a ride home, and I figured the guy's drunk. Let's just give him a ride home.
When did you and Russ talk about jacking him up?
We kind of talked about it at the bar.
Okay, what happened next?
We drove him out past Walmart. We got over there, and he starts grabbing my leg and grabbing my genitals, and I'm like, look, I'm not a fucking faggot. You touch me again, you're going to get it. I don't know what he was trying to do, but I beat him up pretty bad. I killed him.
What'd you beat him with?
I blacked out. My fist, pistol, the butt of the gun. I was wondering what happened. I had a few drinks and I don't know. It was like I could see what was going on, but it was like someone else was doing it.
What was the first thing that he said or that he did in the truck to make you hit him?
Well, he put his hand on my leg and slid his hand like he was going to grab my balls.
When the defense team argued that McKinney did what he did because Matthew made a pass at him, I just wanted to vomit because That's like saying it was okay. It's like the Twinkie defense, like when that guy killed Harvey Milk or Moscow. It's the same thing.
As much as part of me didn't want the defense of them saying that it was a gay bashing or that it was gay panic, part of me was really grateful. Because I was really scared that in the trial they were going to try and say that it was a robbery or drugs or something. So when they used gay panic as their defense, I thought, this is good. If nothing else, the truth is coming out. The truth is going to be told.
Did he ever try to defend himself against you or hit you back?
Yeah, it's sort of. He tried his little swings or whatever, but he wasn't very effective.
Okay, how many times did you hit him inside the truck before you stopped where you left him off?
I'd say maybe two or three, probably three times with my fist and about six times with my pistol.
Did he ask you to stop?
Yeah, he was getting the shit kicked out of him.
What did he say?
After he told me to stop, most all he was doing was screaming.
So Russ kind of dragged him over to the fence and tied him up, I'm assuming.
Something like that. I remember Russ was laughing at first, but then he got really scared.
Was Matthew conscious when Russ tied him up?
Yeah, I remember I told him to turn around and not look at my license plate because I was scared that he was going to tell the cops, so I asked him to read me my license plate, and he did, so that's why I hit him a few more times.
Just to be sure? So, obviously, you don't like gay people.
No, I don't.
Would you say you hate them?
I wouldn't say that I hate them, but, you know, when they start, like, coming on to me and stuff, I get aggravated.
Did he threaten you?
This gay dude?
Yeah.
Not really.
Can you answer me one thing? Why'd you guys take his shoes?
I don't know. Now I'll never get to see my son again.
I don't know. You'll probably go to court sometime today.
Today? So I'm gonna just go in there and plead guilty or not guilty today?
No, you're just gonna be arraigned today.
Is he gonna die for sure?
There is no doubt that Mr. Shepard is going to die.
So what are they going to give me? 25 to life or just the death penalty and get it over with?
That's not our job. That's the judge's job and the jury.
Has the jury reached a verdict?
We have, Your Honor. We, the jury, impaneled and sworn to try the above-entitled case after having well and truly tried the matter, unanimously find as follows. As to the charge of kidnapping, we find the defendant, Aaron James McKinney, guilty. As to the charge of aggravated robbery, we find the defendant, Aaron James McKinney, guilty. As to the charge of first-degree felony murder kidnapping, we find the defendant, Aaron James McKinney, guilty. As to the charge of first-degree felony murder robbery, we find the defendant, Aaron James McKinney, guilty. As to the charge of first-degree premeditated murder, we find the defendant, Aaron James McKinney, not guilty. As to the lesser-included offense of second-degree murder, we find the defendant, Aaron James McKinney, guilty.
Aaron McKinney was found guilty of felony murder, which meant the jury could give him the death penalty. That evening, Judy and Dennis Shepard were approached by McKinney's defense team, who pled for their client's life. The prosecution indicated that they would defer to the family's wishes as to whether or not to pursue the death penalty. The following morning, Dennis Shepard made a statement to the court. Here is some of what he said.
My son, Matthew, did not look like a winner. He was rather uncoordinated, and he wore braces from the time he was 13 until the day he died. However, in his all too brief life, he proved that he was a winner. On October 6th, 1998, my son tried to show the world that he could win again. On October 12th, 1998, my firstborn son and my hero lost. On October 12th, 1998, my firstborn son and my hero died 50 days before his 22nd birthday. I keep wondering the same thing I did when I first saw him in the hospital. What would he have become? How could he have changed his piece of the world and made it better? Matt officially died in a hospital in Fort Collins, Colorado. He actually died on the outskirts of Laramie, tied to a fence. You, Mr. McKinney, with your friend, Mr. Henderson, left him out there by himself. But he was not alone. He had his lifelong friends with him, friends that he had grown up with. You're probably wondering who these friends were. First, he had the beautiful night sky and the stars and the moon that we used to look at through a telescope. Later, he had the sunlight and the sun shining down on him. Through it all, he was breathing in the scent of the pines from the snowy range. He heard the wind, the ever-present Wyoming wind, for the last time. And he had one more friend out there with him. He had God. And I feel better knowing that he wasn't alone. Matt's beating, hospitalization, and funeral focused worldwide attention on hate. Good is coming out of evil. The world has said enough is enough. I miss my son, but I am so proud to be able to say that he is my son. Judy has been quoted as being against the death penalty. It has also been stated that Matt was against the death penalty. Both these statements are wrong. Matt believed that there are crimes and incidents that justified the death penalty. I, too, believe in the death penalty. I would like nothing more than to see you die, Mr. McKinney. However, this is the time to begin the healing process, to show mercy to someone who refused to show any mercy. Mr. McKinney, I am going to grant you life, as hard as it is for me to do so, because of Matthew. Every time you celebrate Christmas, a birthday, the 4th of July, remember that Matt isn't. Every time you wake up in your prison cell, remember that you had the opportunity and the ability to stop your actions that night. You have stolen something very precious from me, and I will never forgive you for that. Mr. McKinney, I give you life in the memory of one who no longer lives. May it be a long life, and may you thank Matthew every day for it.
hugged and cried, and, well, everybody was just, you know, so thankful, and then Mr. Shepard was crying, and that got me bawling.
This is all we lived and breathed for a year, daily. This has been my case, daily, and now it's over.
Maybe now we can go on, and we can quit this stuff, you know?
It just hit me today, the moment that I got out of the courthouse, why God wanted me out there to find him. So he didn't have to die out there alone. Because if I hadn't found him, he would have been out there for a couple of weeks at least. So it makes me feel really good that he didn't have to die out there alone, you know?
I'm just glad it's over. I really am. Testifying in that trial was one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. And don't get me wrong. I love the stage. I do. I love it. But it's tricky because what you have basically is you have the lawyers questioning you from this side, but the answers have to be funneling over here towards the jury. So what you have to do essentially is you have to create like a funneling system, which is hard for me because I'm a natural conversationalist, so I like to look people in the eye when I talk to them. And so it's a little hard to do that when you literally have to scoot over and funnel your answers over towards the jury. But I was able to do that several times over the course of my testimony.
Our last trip, I had the good fortune of seeing Jedediah Schultz play Prior Walter in Angels in America. After a performance, we spoke.
You know, I didn't for the longest time allow myself to get involved in the whole Matthew Shepard situation. It just didn't seem real. It seemed way blown out of proportion. Matthew Shepard was just a name instead of an individual. I don't know. It's weird. It's so weird. I just feel bad for the person that I used to be and all, and that's why I want to hear those tapes from a year ago when we did those interviews. I just can't believe I ever said that stuff about homosexuals, you know? I mean, how did I ever let that stuff make me think that you were any different than me?
This is Romaine Patterson.
Well, a year ago, I wanted to be a rock star. That was my goal. And now, well, it's obviously changed in the fact that over the last year, I've really realized my role in taking my part. So now, instead of going to school for music, I'm going to school for communications and political science. Well, because I've got a career in political activism. Actually, I just found out I was invited to Washington, D.C. to be honored by the Anti-Defamation League. And whenever I think about the Angels or any of the speaking that I've done, it's like Matthew gave me it. It's like Matt's guiding this path for me to walk down with his light. And whenever we get to a door, he opens it. And then he just says, okay, next step. And if I get to be a rock star on the side, okay.
This is Jonas Lonergan.
Change is not an easy thing. I don't think people were up to it here. They got what they wanted. Those two boys got what they deserved. And we look good now, just as it has been served, the OK Corral. We shot down the villains, we sent the prostitutes on the train, the town's cleaned up, and we don't need to talk about it anymore. You know, it's been a year since Matthew Shepard died, and they haven't passed shit in Wyoming. At a state level, any town, anywhere, any kind of laws, anti-discrimination laws, hate crime legislation, nobody's passed anything anywhere. What's come out of it? What's come out of this that's concrete or lasting?
We say we meet again one last time at the fence.
I've been up to that site in my limousine. And I remember to myself what Matt said to me the night we drove around. He said, Laramie sparkles, doesn't it? And where he was up there, if you go to that exact spot where he was up there, Laramie sparkles from up there. With this low-lying cloud and it's bouncing like the blue lights from the airport. It goes tss, 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 over the whole city. I mean, it blows you away. And Matt was right there. And in his eyes, I can just picture what he was seeing. thing he saw on this earth was the sparkling lights.
We spent the last 2 days packing a year's worth of materials and saying our goodbyes. We've been here 6 times and conducted over 200 interviews. Jedediah cried when he said goodbye.
Marge wished us luck, and when we asked her how Laramie would feel seeing a play about itself, she said,
I think we'd enjoy it. To show it's not the hellhole of the earth would be nice, but that depends on how you portray us. And that, in turn, depends on how Laramie behaves.
As we were hanging up, she said to me,
Now you take care. I love you, honey.
Doc asked me if I wanted to ghostwrite a book about the whole event. Galloway offered me or anyone else a place to stay if and when we come back to Laramie. He also seemed interested as to whether there'd be an open audition for this play.
We left Laramie at about 7 in the evening. On our way to Denver, I looked in the rearview mirror to get one last look at the town.
And I will speak with you. I trust that if you write a play of this, you will say it right. You must do your best to stay correct.
And in the distance, I could see the sparkling lights of Laramie, Wyoming.
No, Mike Smith does. Okay. He's great. That's great. He's great.